Well, good morning to everybody who's here. There's a lot of good discussion, smiling faces that I can see from here. So a very warm welcome to you this morning. And the sun's even shining. I've decided to stand this side because it's too bright just there. So it'll shift as we go. But a very warm welcome to Ebenezer this morning. We're glad you can be here and that we come to worship our God. And as we do so, before we sing some songs, as we open the Bible and we read from that, and then we have a message based on that talk, I'm going to start with Psalm 97. This is the God that we can come and sing to and hear from this morning. Psalm 97, verse 9. For you, Lord, are the most high over all the earth. You are exalted far above all gods. Let those who love the Lord hate evil, for he guards the lives of his faithful ones and delivers them from the hand of the wicked. Light shines on the righteous and joy on the upright in heart. Rejoice in the Lord, you who are righteous, and praise his holy name. Let's pray together before we sing together. Thank you, God, so much that we can come together today, that we come here, we can gather together, and that we can worship you. Thank you, God, that we can approach you as Lord, as King, and as our Saviour. And we do this today, and we ask that it brings glory and honour to your name. In Jesus' name, amen. So we'll stand and sing our first song, Rejoice, the Lord is King. And we can approach this King. So let's stand together.
Rejoice, the Lord is King, your Lord and King adore. Mortals give thanks and sing and triumph evermore. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say. The Saviour reigns, the God of truth and love. When he had purged our stains, he took his seat above. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say. His kingdom cannot fail. He rules both earth and heaven. The keys of death and hell to Jesus now I give. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say rejoice. He sits at God's right hand till all his foes submit and bow to his command and fall beneath his feet. Lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, rejoice. Rejoice in glorious hope, Jesus the Judge shall come and take his servants up to their eternal. angel's voice, the trumpet sound. Rejoice, rejoice.
Please take your seats.
Yep, too bright there. Wonderful singing. It's great when you actually sit up the front because everyone's behind you can hear the voices. So that's an encouragement to sit, you know, further up the front because then you can hear the singing. I didn't bring the bulletin up, but on the front of the bulletin, you'll see you would have received one of them when you come in. And on the front, it has the church office hours. Just drawing your attention that the office 9 to 12 on a Monday and a Thursday. That's when the office hours, so if you're looking at knowing when, 9 to 12, Monday and Thursday, that's on the front there. We also had the security alarm installed, so we will need to make sure that it's, you know, turned off if you're coming here, turned on when you leave here, and it is just in the hallway near the toilets. There are codes. Please see Toby or Jenna for those. After our Term 2 trial of the NIV Bible, Session have adopted this as our Bible choice moving forward. So we'll be having NIV as our Bible readings and adopted in use. Next week, Lord's Supper. Just a reminder, that'll be August the 6th. Yes, it'll be another month. And also happening mid-August is the AV and Music Workshop. We're looking to try and do a bit of a, we'll do a little bit separate and then we'll come together because we work together quite regularly on Sundays. It's helpful for the AV people to know what to control on the music levels, but we need the music input for those levels. So if you're interested in playing music here, if you play an instrument but you're not sure about playing it here, still have a chat with Sam. Or if you're interested in doing some sound or data, or you're interested in video, come and have a chat with me. We're always looking for more people to be involved, and if it's something you've thought about, just come and have a chat. And then we'll do some training and discussion, and you can see, is it something you want to be a part of? And then we're giving advance notice, save the date for 9th of September. There is the Women's Conference, and that one is down in Warrnambool. So put that one in your calendar and save that date. So that's 9th of September. We'll move into the next announcement. So I'll invite Sam to come up. No, don't stand in the sun because you won't see anyone.
That's okay. Thank you.
So, Sam, I thought I'd ask a question that's not on my list and one that I didn't actually prepare you with. Can you tell us something interesting about you?
No, I'm a very boring person. But by God's grace, I enjoy life. And so, praise God. Interesting, I grew up playing the French horn, so I don't play it much these days. But that's a bit of a niche instrument that I have enjoyed, certainly in the past. And it may creep out from time to time for the children's amusement.
Yeah. What about the music workshop? Will there be
if you're a French horn player, you know, we won't say no, but, you know. Yeah.
All right. So, we'll see. So, that once again, that's another plug for the workshop coming up.
Yes, do come.
But what we're interested in here is the kids' holiday program. It's up on the screen, but what is this kids' holiday program?
Yes, so first and foremost, kids, get excited because this September, school holidays, in the second week, we're going to have a club that meets here every day, Monday to Friday, in that second week, and we're going on an Egyptian adventure. So it's an opportunity for primary school kids to come along, and we're going to be looking at the story of Joseph in the Bible. And we're going to be doing that in an Egyptian theme suitable to the Joseph story.
So the story will kind of come to life a little.
Definitely.
All right. So we're running this kids' holiday program. why are we running a kids' holiday program? Why would we do that?
Well, of course, we run a kids' program every Sunday during term, during our service, which is wonderful to build up our young people in the Lord. But we also want to share Jesus with those who don't come to church every Sunday. And that's what this kids' holiday club is about. So yes, we want all of you kids to be able to come if you can, but we don't just want you to come, we want you to bring your friends. We want other kids from Ballarat, from your school maybe, or from your local neighbourhood. We would love you to bring friends to the club so that they can hear about the story of Joseph and how Joseph points us to Jesus in the Bible. And we'll have a lot of fun doing that with the Egyptian theme. Also, grandparents, if you've got kids who are at primary school and you're like, I'd really love to get them involved in something that talks about the gospel, then this is a great opportunity to potentially invite your grandkids along to something that we run at church. Yeah.
All right, so that's how we can involve the kids and the grandparents. But for anyone else, how else can they help with this program?
Yeah, so it's a pretty big task to get this club up and running. I'll be coordinating it, but yeah, I'm just one person. And so I really need a whole team of people to help in putting on this holiday program. And so that involves up the front stuff, you know, being able to communicate the story of Joseph and to do that in an upfront way. But more than that, we actually need people to be able to do things like welcoming when parents rock up with their kids to drop them off. Also, we're providing morning tea for the kids and for any parents that want to stay around. So we'd love a whole team of people to say, yeah, I'd love to help out in the kitchen preparing things or making cups of tea, talking to grown-ups who want to stick around. And then there's also like small group time where we're going to be making things out of paddle pop sticks and all those fun things that you do as a kid. And so we'll need, yeah, it's lots of hands on deck. There's probably a few, yeah, job descriptions I've missed there. But yeah, basically, I think it'll take, you know, about 30 to 50 of us to be able to actually pull this off well. Thanks to all those who've already signed up. But if you're interested in willing, I'd love to talk to you about I think anyone here could help in some way. Yeah.
That's quite a team that'll be there. How can we be praying for the kids' holiday program? And we will pray straight after your answer.
Yeah, so the first prayer request I have is to pray that God would motivate people to come and motivate each of us to have the courage to invite people to come to the holiday club. Also pray that we can, put together a team that, you know, would be able to be free to run the program well. And pray that in the preparations and in running the program, we would be able to keep our eyes fixed on giving the praise to Jesus and helping others to see how good it is to be in a relationship with God. Yeah.
All right, well, let's pray for the kids' holiday program now. Lord God, we thank you for the kids' holiday program that's coming up in September. Lord, we thank you as Sam leads this one. We pray that you would be at work in assembling the team. Lord, we thank you for each one who can be involved, and we do pray that you would provide people to help with welcoming, whether it's the food, whether it's leading segments. Lord, we pray that they would see the need of kids to hear about you. And Lord, we pray for many kids in our community. We pray for the kids in our church that they would invite their friends, their neighbours. And Lord, we do pray that there would be many who have never heard of you that come along and hear about you for the first time. And Lord, we do pray that people would learn to put their trust and their hope in you. Lord, it's not just an activity program to fill in time in the holidays. Lord, we do want people to hear about you. Lord, we pray for you to assemble the team to lead and bring it to fruition. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you, Sam. It's now time for some of those kids. No, all the kids can come up the front, and I'll invite Chris, who's going to do the kids' talk.
Coming down, guys. We'll sit in the sun. All right, we got enough room for everyone? Come on, guys. Now, I'm going to need a couple of helpers this time, but I'll point you out in a moment. Keep coming down. Does anyone know what this is? What, a suitcase? Not a suitcase? What do you reckon it is? A pencil case. This is a very special pencil case. Can you read what's on there, Izzy? Derwents. Anyone know what Derwents are? What are Derwents? Whoa, I just got my head stuck. Derwents are pencils. And these are very special pencils. These are Mez's special pencils that were given to her by her mum, and she loves them, and they're all very special, and they're all very different. There's no two the same. So, some of them, like this one, are sharp and pointy. Do you want to hold that one for me? Come and stand up next to me. Sharp and pointy one. Some of them are blunt and well-rounded. Do you want to hold that one for me, Jemima? Come and stand up. Some of them are like new. They've barely been used at all. Do you want to hold that one up for me? And others are very old, worn out, and what's happened to that one? Broken. Come on, Lloyd, hold this one up for me. There we go. Some are thin and short. Thin and short one. Do you want, Bronte, can you hold that one up? And some are thick and tall. Who can hold this one for me? Oh, how about Annie? You want to hold the thick and tall one? There we go. Some of them look very expensive. Look at that. Gold and silver. Thanks, Jay. Come on up. Oh, sorry. Yeah, come and grab them. You hold them up in there. And some of them are... Oh dear. Is that chewing gum? Some of them are looking a little bit dirty. Chewing gum, sticky tape. I don't know what. Someone put that up their nose? Who wants to hold this one? Jake, you're a legend. You hold that one. Well done. Yep, stand at the end. And some of them are very, very bright. Go for it. Yeah, here we go. Man, we almost got everyone up here. Some are very dull, and some are even grayer than others. Who wants to hold the gray heads? Go for it. There we go. Some are dark. Thanks, Joseph. And some are pale. There we go. And some of them are brown. Look at all the different tones of brown there are. Thank you, Zoe. Oh, okay, Zoe. Nice. Some of them have really strange names, but others have names that you might recognize. So what's this one? Ah, here's an old pencil called Scarlet. Who'd like to hold Scarlet? There we go. And here's a new pencil called Indigo. Go for it. Oh, what is this tiny little one? It's a little Hazel. Who would like to hold Hazel? All right, Nora, come and hold Hazel. Be very careful with her. There we go. Now, we can learn a lot from all these pencils. Even though they're all very, very different, they all fit in the pencil case, all in the same box, and they all belong to Mez, and she loves every single one of them. Do you guys who are left, do you have any favorites here? Any favorite pencils? Don't answer. Just wait. Don't answer that. Because we're not actually talking about pencils this morning. Do you think I'd get down here just to talk about Mez's pencils? No. The pencils are a good picture of what the church must be. Oh, keep listening, guys. Keep listening. Hello, thank you. All right. The people that make up a church come in all shapes and sizes and lots of different colors. Some have names that are a little bit hard to say. Some are old and some are young. Some wear silver and gold, while others might wear clothes that are a bit worn out and have holes in them. Now, in the Bible, there's a guy called James, and he wrote, "Brothers and sisters, believers in our glorious God, these people must not show favoritism," which means people in the church must treat everyone as good as the other. You must not have anyone that you like or treat better than anyone else. So when it comes to people, guys, you cannot have favorites, okay? James explained, actually, Micah, you guys, everyone sit down for a moment. You can hold on to your pencils, though. Keep remembering. Does anyone remember what their pencil represents? Not God, the church. That's right. We've got old pencils, young pencils, gray pencils, and bright pencils. And we've got pencils that have got blue tack stuck to them, or they've got things that have gone up people's noses. That's a bit weird. Now, James explains that if a rich person wearing fancy clothes and a gold ring comes into church, and a poor person dressed in worn out old clothes comes in, we can't treat one better than the other. We can't say, oh, you can have this nice seat with the cushion to the rich person, and say to the poor person, oh, do you mind just sitting at the back on the floor, or not on the carpet, you might get it dirty, just on the hardwood. You can't treat people like that. No. You mustn't give, yeah, that is the same thing as saying someone is better than another, which the Bible says is wrong. We must be careful not to show favoritism in our church or anywhere else, because God has chosen lots of people. Jesus died for the rich and for the poor. He chose the fast kids and the slow kids, the tall kids and the short kids, smart kids and the not so bright kids, boys and girls. He loves the old and the young. He has saved people of all kinds of eye color, hair color, and skin color. And he has brought into this family lots of precious people, including a scarlet, an indigo, and a hazel. Now, I don't think any of them are here today, so next week you're going to have to try and find those three people in our church. As James said, you will all do right if you obey the most important law in Scripture, and it's the law that commands us to love others as much as we love ourselves. How about we pray? Let's pray. Dear God, help us to love one another as you have loved us, showing us how every person is loved by you. Change our hearts to not play favorites with your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Can I have all Mez's favorite pencils back? Thank you. And I think, are we having a kids' song? No? Kids, you can go out to Ebbs or out to, thank you for Mr. Thick. Or kids out to Crash. Thanks for the grey heads. Thank you.
Please stand as we sing "All I Have Is Christ."
Me first, I would refuse you still.
We now will have a time of prayer. I'll lead us in that time of prayer. So let's pray together now. Heavenly Father, we do give you praise for your immense love and your faithfulness. Lord, we see your love and faithfulness through Jesus Christ, just as we've been singing. If all we have is Christ, that is all we need, Lord. We thank you for the forgiveness of our sins, the restoring of the relationship with you. Lord, we thank you that we can come to you. We thank you that you do love us and you are faithful to us. Lord, forgive us when we're unloving or unfaithful to you. Be it in the last few days or weeks, Lord, forgive us when we haven't lived how we should, when we've ignored you, dishonored you, and deceived ourselves that we know better or what's right. Lord, we ask that you forgive us. Lord, we thank you for the gift of sunshine over the last few days and the joy that it brings many of us. Lord, we thank you that it's warm, it's bright, rather than those feelings of maybe bleak or freezing or the windy weather. Lord, we thank you for the seasons that you have set in place. We thank you that we do look forward to warm weather and things like that in the future, just as we can look forward to Jesus' return. Lord, we pray for those who might be suffering at the moment. Lord, whether it's from sickness, whether it's grieving the loss of loved ones, or Lord, it's those who might be struggling financially. Lord, we uplift them to you. We ask that they know your love, your comfort. Lord, we ask for you to provide what they need each day. We thank you for your love and care. Motivate us towards love and care for others too. Lord, we pray that we would see you at work in people's lives. Lord, we uplift those not overseas, but missions. We pray for Josh and Ali Flynn in Arnhem Land. Lord, we thank you for their following of your leading to the top end of Australia. Lord, as they help with the Yolngu people, we thank you for their children, and that we pray that you would help them in engaging with other families and other children in that community. Lord, would you help them to know how to share about you and that they would be a light for you there. We pray too for their protection, especially against spiritual attacks. Lord, we pray that your word would go forth, that people would hear about Jesus and that they would put their trust and their hope in him. Lord, we also pray for overseas, and we pray for the Christians, especially in Manipur in India. Lord, it's saddening and tragic to hear of the recent developments. Lord, it's horrific what has happened. We pray for the many that are suffering, and particularly the women, that they would know your comfort at this time. Lord, would you work in healing their pain, their memories, the humiliation, and the grief that they've experienced. And Lord, we do pray for the Prime Minister in India that they will start acknowledging and acting against the persecution of Christians and other minority groups by the rising Hindu nationalism. Lord, we pray that you would protect the Christians, encourage and embolden them. Lord, we do pray that they would be able to return to their homes, to their communities. And Lord, we pray that you would provide their needs as they've had to flee homes, seeking safety and protection. Lord, we pray for many others who might be in this same situation around the world, and we pray that you would be at work. Lord, we lift these things on our hearts and other things that we are thinking and praying about. Lord, we uplift them to you We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we have our Bible reading and we have the message, we'll stand and sing another song, Before the Throne. And the interesting line in this, Christ my Saviour and my God. We could acknowledge that Christ has saved people, but we might not see him as our Saviour. Or we might go, well, yeah, I believe in God, but he's not my God. And there's a difference there, Christ my Saviour and my God. So as we stand and sing, we'll be reflecting on these.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong, a perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is written on his hand, my name is hidden in his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no power can force me to depart. No power can force me to depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. To look on him and pardon me. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect sinless righteousness. The great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with my Lord I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood. My life is safe with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God.
Please take a seat.
Our Bible reading this morning is 1 Samuel 1, verse 6. David again brought together all the young able men of Israel, 30,000. He and all his men went to Baal in Judea to bring up from there the Ark of God, which is called by the name and the name of the Lord Almighty, who is enthroned between the cherub on the Ark. They set the Ark of God on a new cart and bought it from the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. Uzzah and Ahio, sons of Abinadab, were guiding the new cart with the ark on it, and Ahio was walking in front of it. David and all Israel were celebrating with all their might before the Lord with castanets, harps, lyres, timbrels, sistrums, and cymbals. When they came to the threshing floor of Nacon, Azar reached out and took hold of the ark of God because the oxen stumbled. The Lord's anger burned against Azar, and because of his irreverent act, therefore God struck him down and he died there beside the ark of God. Then David was angry because the Lord's wrath had broken out against Azar. And to this day, that place is called Perez Azar. David was afraid of the Lord that day and said, "How can the ark of the Lord ever come to me?" He was not willing to take the ark of the Lord to be with him in the city of David. Instead, he took it to the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. The ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite for 3 months, and the Lord blessed him and his entire household. Now King David was told, "The Lord has blessed the household of Obed-Edom and everything he has because of the ark of God." So David went to bring the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with rejoicing. When those who were carrying the ark of the Lord had taken six steps, he sacrificed a bull and a fattened calf. Wearing a linen ephod, David was dancing before the Lord with all his might, while he and all Israel were bringing up the ark of the Lord with shouts and the sounds of trumpets. As the ark of the Lord was entering the city of David, Michal, daughter of Saul, watched from a window. And when she saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, she despised him in her heart. They brought the ark of the Lord and set it in its place inside the tent that David had pitched for it. And David sacrificed burnt offerings and fellowship offerings before the Lord. After he'd finished sacrificing the burnt offerings and the fellowship offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord Almighty. Then he gave a loaf of bread, a cake of dates, and a cake of raisins to each person in the whole crowd of Israelites, both men and women, and all the people went to their homes. When David returned home to bless his household, Michal, daughter of Saul, came out to meet him and said, "How the king of Israel has distinguished himself today, going around half naked in full view of the slave girls of his servants as any vulgar fellow would." David said to Michal, "It was before the Lord who chose me rather than your father or anyone from his house when he appointed me ruler over the Lord's people of Israel. I will celebrate before the Lord. I will become even more undignified than this, and I will be humiliated in my own eyes. But by these slave girls you spoke of, I will be held in honor." And Michal, daughter of Saul, had no children to the day of her death. Blessed be this reading.
Thank you, Joss. Morning, everyone. We're in Samuel. I'm going to do a bit of a summary of chapter 5, and then we'll spend some time in chapter 6. Let's pray. Father God, we do thank you for the time we have seeing the life of David and his rise and then fall as king. Lord, we ask that you'd speak to us through your word this morning and help me to preach according to your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Have you ever been in a situation where you thought you were in control? You had it all together. You thought you knew what was going to happen. You know, you're getting ready for that big event, and then the power goes off, and you've got no backup. Or maybe you planned your morning, you're on time for that very important meeting, and then the car breaks down. Maybe it's a photo day at school, and you're all ready, but then you can't find that piece of uniform, or the hair's just not right, or that zit appears. Or maybe you've got everything sorted, and then something comes up out of nowhere. Now we're going to see what David thought, that he was in control, that he was the king, he was in control, but actually he wasn't. And so last week, if you're joining us, we had a struggle between two warriors. David's commander, Joab, he was victorious, but with great cost. And David was in the process of becoming king, but it was messy and costly. In chapter 5, there's three key developments about the establishment of David. The elders of Israel, they come to David, they anoint him as king over the 12 tribes. Before this, he was only king over Judah. Now it's all of Israel. He's 30 years of age when he becomes king. And he obviously didn't have to wait as long as Charlie did, you know, because he's got the record, right? But David had to be patient, didn't he? And he was anointed as a teenager, and then he fled from Saul, life on the run, patiently waiting for the Lord to remove Saul. And then verse 5 tells us he was in Hebron as king for 6 years, and it took him 6 months to capture Jerusalem, and from there he reigned 33 years. Now, capturing Jerusalem, it was almost mission impossible. The Jebusites, they were in control. Joshua couldn't do it. The Israelites were never able to capture this city. In fact, it was the last place to be conquered in the Promised Land. The Jebusites, they knew they were up high, they had a fortress, they believed it was impenetrable. So they mocked David and they call him all sorts of things. But with God's help, he's able to capture Jerusalem. That's a very clever political move by David. It's actually the perfect place to have a new capital. It's never been occupied by any of the tribes of Israel, so it's symbolic. The Promised Land is now occupied. It's naturally a great fortress. It's probably the safest place from invasion. And it's a bit like Canberra, you know? It's the in-between nowhere place that no one's ever been. But you set it up and then, you know, the other cities don't argue, right? All the different tribes would have been happy for the capital B in their tribe, but Jerusalem, that's perfect. And so he establishes his position. Verse 11, he receives tributes from the king of Tyre and he builds himself a palace. Verse 13, he takes on more wives and concubines and has more children. Now these are warning signs for us about David, because David's becoming like all the other kings. He set up his capital. He's got his palace with the cedar. And now he's got a luxurious palace and he's growing a harem. He's taking on more and more wives and now concubines. The Philistines are not happy because David has united Israel and become their king. And so they come out in force to fight him. In verse 17, he inquires of the Lord. Notice he's not fighting them in his own strength. He's saying, should I attack them? Will you deliver them into my hands? And twice the Lord delivers them into David's hands. But note, it's the Lord's army of angels that defeat them. And there's a key phrase in verse 20 of chapter 5 up on the screen. As waters break out, the Lord has broken out against my enemies before me. David's like, this is fabulous. How good is this? The Lord breaks out against the Philistines. I'm the king. And so he's got his palace, he's got his capital, he's defeated his main enemy, but it's not all about him. He understands it's the Lord who has established him. He understands it's actually the Lord has given him everything. Like as a teenager, it was the Lord that delivered him from the lions. It was the Lord who delivered him from Goliath. All his various battles and numerous attempts on his life, the Lord has been with him, blessed him, and kept him. And so it's very right and proper that he should bring the ark to Jerusalem. Jerusalem is the new capital, the new center. The ark has to be at the center. The Lord is at the center of everything Israel and David do. And the ark being the presence, the symbolic presence of the Lord, it needs to be in Jerusalem. He doesn't want it just to be the political center, but the religious center. The place where people come, the place where Israel gathers to worship the Lord, it will be the center of everything. And we read that in the Bible, don't we? From now on, we always go back to Zion, the house of the city of David. Jerusalem becomes the center of everything. But the ark's been on the sidelines for some time. The Philistines, you remember, they captured it, they returned it, but it hasn't moved. Saul never moved it. David was in no position to move it. And the last mention is back in 1 Samuel chapter 7. We'll just read the first two verses up on the screen. Thank you, Nathan. So the men of Kithrath, Jerim, came up and took the ark of the Lord. They brought it to Abinadab's house on the hill and consecrated as Elijah, his son, to guard the ark of the Lord. The ark remained at that place a long time, 20 years in all. So David is keen. He wants to get the ark, right? So what does he do? He gathers all the young men. It's a time of celebration, music, instruments. Let's get a brand new ark, boys. Huzzah and Hiyo, they're in charge. Well, where's their brother Elel? And what's his name? I can't even say his name. Ekelzer. Here's a guy, here's the brother consecrated to guard the ark. What is he? No longer with us? Is he away on holidays? Not sure, but his brothers are in charge. And they put it on the ark. One's at the front, one's in the back. And verse 6, the oxen stumble. Huzzah sees the ark moving, maybe coming off the ark. Ooh, he reaches out, grabs it, maybe pushes it back on, maybe stops it from falling off the ark. Then the Lord kills him for touching the ark. And David's like, just trying to do this. He gets angry. Verse 8, David was angry because the Lord's wrath had broken out against Huzzah. You see, the tables have turned. The Lord's wrath had broken out on the Philistines in battle, the chapter before. Now the Lord's broken out on his own people. And David's scared. Who am I to go against the Lord? What? I thought you were on my side, God. Righto, I'm not touching it, boys. Let's leave it here and back to Jerusalem. And they leave the ark with a foreigner. Now, when we read this, we think, whoa, this is harsh. This is super harsh. You know, poor old, how do you say his name? Huzzah. Right, poor old Huzzah, he's just trying to help, isn't he? He's walking behind the ark. He sees the ark about to fall. He's like, oh, no, we can't have that. Touches the ark. He's dead. Background is helpful. The ark is symbolizing a holy God being in his people. A holy God that ordinary people, sinful people, are not allowed to go near or they will die. But God, in his mercy and kindness, gave very clear instructions how to approach the ark. And it was only the priests that could approach it. They had to offer sacrifices. And only certain people could move it. And it had very particular ways to move the ark. Exodus 35 and verses 12 and 15 up on the screen. Verse 12, cast four gold rings for it, fasten them on its four feet, with two rings on each side and two rings on the other. Then make poles of acacia wood and overlay them with gold. Insert the poles into the ring on the sides of the ark to carry it. The poles are to remain in the rings of the ark and they are not to be removed. Very precise, very clear. Long poles that go in the rings, and that's how you carry the ark, on shoulders. And it was the priests. But the thing is, it's been a long time since anyone's moved the ark, about 20 years. Maybe David, he'd heard about how the Philistines put it on a new cart and put it back to Israel. Maybe he didn't consult the Levites. There's no Levites present at the start of chapter 6. And maybe he didn't double check the law. Maybe no one said, oh, what did Moses tell us about? Oh, what did God tell Moses? Whatever the case, they haven't handled the ark as they should. And just like David's approach to the Lord, our approach has to be the right way. Because you can be really sincere, but completely wrong. Yeah? So imagine you're an American. And you're an amazing driver. And you're an American, so you're sincere, yeah? They're very sincere, unlike Australians. You're an excellent American driver. And you come to Australia. Doesn't matter how good a driver you are, if someone doesn't tell you, hey, buddy, you got to drive on the left, you're going to cause an accident. Because you're going to drive like you did back home. You're going to drive on the right-hand side of the road. And, oh, what are these cars doing on the wrong-hand side of the road? Or maybe you're a very sincere friend and you want to prove your love, devotion to your mate, and you make them a delicious peanut butter sandwich. You don't know they've got a peanut allergy that could, you know, clock their throat and they gasp for, you know, kill them, but you sincerely love them and you want to do the right thing. Sincerity is nice, but it is not always what's going to help. Now, a large proportion of people, they just ignore God. And they're very sincere about it. They say, oh, I can't see any relevance for God. Many people, they just don't acknowledge God. They don't want to live His way. And a lot believe that they're good, that they are good, decent people, and that God will accept them. And they're very sincere about it. And even the arguments people put against God, it's very sincere and it makes sense. If God is real, let Him prove it. Notice that whole statement, it's the person saying it on my terms. On my terms, if God's real, I want Him to show me. If God is good, there will be no suffering. Again, the assumption is that humans are good and that suffering is always evil. If God is all powerful, then there would be no natural disasters. Again, the assumption is humanity is innocent and we're innocent of the decaying world and the state of the world. See, that's the thing. We think we can approach God on our terms, just like David. But God's the creator. He's the one who created everything. He's the one that sustains us. I even breathe now because of the Lord's mercy. And He is our judge. He will judge everyone. When we come to God, we come on His terms, not ours. See, David here is a bit like all of us. He's got a plan. He believes he knows what is right. He's very sincere. He thinks he's doing the right thing. But he doesn't ask God how to do it. He thinks he knows best. But God is very clear on how we are to approach Him. As a result of David's approach, someone dies. So the question is, how are we approaching God? Are we trying to approach Him on our terms or on His? Although we may think we've got it all sorted, we need to do it God's way, not ours. And it is by God's grace, is it not? When we approach God, we bring nothing. We can't say to God, well, I've got this and that. What have you got? And God gives it all to us. And that's why Jesus came into the world. Jesus came because we couldn't go to Him. Jesus came because there's no way sinful people like me and you can approach a holy God. But this is the ripper news, that when the Son of God died on the cross, when He died and paid the punishment for us, the curtain was torn in the temple. The curtain that kept sinful people like me out from a holy God and dying, like poor old user with the cart, was torn because Jesus' blood amended all our sin, all our wrath, all our evil. It's through Jesus we approach God on God's terms, not ours. And so we go back to Samuel 6, and David is told that Obed-Edom, his household is being blessed. The last time the Lord's Ark was in possession of foreigners, it was tumors, it was nastiness, it was death, it was judgment. And this time, old Eben, his whole household is being blessed. And David realizes, hang on a minute, I'm missing out. I want the Lord's blessing on my household. So he attempts again. But this time it's very different. See, the first time it was like a military procession. This time it's a religious procession. They carry the ark on the right way. David has got the priests attire on, And for every six steps, I reckon this is a bit David, just being safe, but also just making sure, you know, it's all, I know you're God, God, and I'm just a bloke, and I'm just going to, this is going to cost me, right? So every six steps, a calf and a bull are sacrificed. And David's dancing with all his might. And verse 16 informs us that Michal is watching David dancing before the Lord. Notice she's referred to as the daughter of Saul, not David's wife. And she despises David in her heart. Remember last week, David had given the order and the husband that loved her, she was taken from. And here she is, stuck in David's household. And she can't stand what she sees, David dancing so publicly. David brings the ark into the tent. He offers sacrifices, burnt offerings, fellowship offerings. He gives out heaps of food to all the people. Everyone is blessed. And then David comes home to bless his household, but there's tension, not blessing. Michal is waiting and ready. She comes out, rebukes him publicly, and you can hear her sarcasm. Verse 20, how the king of Israel has distinguished himself today, going around half naked in full view of slave girls of his servants as any vulgar fellow would. Now remember, David is king. What he does goes, and we're going to see that tragically in the coming weeks. No one dares speak against the king. No one dares speak unless you're asked, let alone rebuke him publicly. She questions his conduct. That is no way the king of Israel is to act. But David is not perturbed. He's not put off. Straight back. It was before the Lord who chose me rather than your father or anyone from his house when he anointed me ruler over the Lord's people Israel. I will celebrate before the Lord. I'll even become even more undignified than this. And I will be humiliated in my own eyes. But these slave girls you spoke of, I'll be held in honor. It's horrible, isn't it? It's all bang, bang. That's intense. He rebukes her. He makes it quite clear. Listen here. The Lord anointed me, not your dad, not your brothers. He anointed me, and I'm going to celebrate before the Lord how I desire, and I don't care what you think. You think I was indignified? I'm going to be even more indignified. I'm going to humiliate myself even more. But you know those slave girls you're talking about? They actually admire my humble dancing and my dedication to the Lord. And the last verse informs us that Michal had no children to the day of her death. Now, back in the day, a wife's security, her status was with the children, but it's also highlighting her position. She is a widow in David's palace. This may have been the last time that David spoke to her. Her life basically over. She's a prisoner in the king's house. She has no status, no purpose, no future. She was brave, she was bold, but it cost her everything. The line of Saul will end with her. And so let's think about ourselves. Let's think about our own lives. We've got so much to do, haven't we? So much to do, so little time, so much that we need to do. And often we kind of think we've got it under control. We know what we're doing. And David, he was a powerful man. He was a warrior, the best among warriors. But it was only because of God's grace and favor that he succeeded. Without God, he was nothing. Now, we can plan as much as we like. We can have the best diaries, the best planners. We can work as hard as we want. We can be busy, busy, busy. But without the Lord's blessing, it's all for naught. Friends, we are in such a better position than King David. We live on the other side of the cross. We live knowing that Jesus is the only way to God, knowing that Jesus died on the cross for us, knowing that Jesus rose from the grave. That's one thing to know, it's another thing to live. Now, David, he had to learn the hard way in his approach to God. He had to learn in the hard way that he wasn't in control, and we're going to see that he's going to continue to learn the hard way in the coming weeks. And often, you know, we have to learn the hard way, don't we? Often God allows us to suffer. Often God, you know, we kind of think everything's sweet, and all of a sudden a little accident, you know, and everything unravels. It's so easy to think that we're in control. But friends, Jesus is in control. And we've got to rely on the one who is in control rather than ourselves. Let's pray. Our Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for scripture and the way in which it teaches us that one of the most powerful men ever wasn't in control. We thank you that we can learn through David's example. Father God, help us to approach you humbly and help us to approach you on your terms, not on our own. We do pray for those who think that they are in control, who think that they can set the terms. We pray that you would help them to see that they are not in control. And Father God, for us, when we have setbacks, when we have disappointments, help us to not just grit our teeth, help us to not just try harder, work harder, do better, but help us to draw back to Jesus and rely on him. We thank you that Jesus is in control, and we thank you that because of his death, we can approach you. And because of Jesus' death, there is no division between a holy God and us. We thank you because of Jesus, we not only can approach you, but we have the Holy Spirit living in us. Help us to depend on Jesus each day. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing our last song, Only a Holy God. And one of the verses, what other glory consumes like fire? What other power can raise the dead? What other name remains undefeated? Only a holy God. It is only our God, only the holy God that is in control. Let's stand as we sing.
Can win.
we're singing about, and I pray that, like me, you can say it's my holy God. This morning we have been humbled, challenged in how we approach a holy God, but we thank Jesus who has made that way. It's not us who has to work out a way or try and figure out what to do. Jesus is that way that we can approach a holy God. Thank you for being here this morning. We do go through for morning tea in the hall, but it's nice and sunny. You can grab a cuppa and be out in the sunshine as well. So feel free to make your way out the back and grab a cuppa, and we'll see you next Sunday.